You can hear, can you hear me? So today we'll be discussing a topic which is very prevalent in India. The incidence is very high. So when you have been posted in surgery clinics, the past history that you take, when you ask the past history of a patient, the thing you ask the patient is whether the patient has any history of chronic illness like hypertension, diabetes, and tuberculosis. Why tuberculosis? Because the burden of tuberculosis is very high in India, and it is a very chronic health problem. So to go into the introduction, this is a generalized introduction of the tuberculosis as such. So it is a common disease in India and other developing countries. India is home to around 26% of the world TB cases. The total TB cases, out of that 26% of the total cases are in India. And one more important thing is, it is of relevance because the number of HIV positive patients in India is very high. And it has been seen that TB and HIV are very much correlated. Now, to know the importance of tuberculosis, if you see this slide, in 2010, the global incidence was 9.4 million. And out of that, in India, it was total of 2.3 million. 40% of total Indians harbored the tuberculosis bacilli. As per 2015 data, it is not given in the slide, but in 2015, 28 lakh new cases of tuberculosis were diagnosed in India, and the death because of tuberculosis in 2015 was 4.8 lakhs. Now, what we're talking about is tuberculosis as a whole, which includes pulmonary as well as extrapulmonary tuberculosis. And out of extrapulmonary tuberculosis, the sixth most common type is the abdominal tuberculosis. Now, the commonest extrapulmonary tuberculosis is tuberculosis of the spine, followed by genitourinary tract, the lymph nodes, bones, the meninges, and the sixth is the abdominal tuberculosis. So, out of all the extrapulmonary tuberculosis, abdominal cox is the sixth most common type of extrapulmonary cox. Now, now, before going into the etiology, let's know about some risk factors for abdominal cox. The slide here is not given, just I'll mention some risk factors for abdominal cox. So it is seen that patients suffering from cirrhosis, who have HIV infection, diabetes mellitus, any underlying malignancy, patients on treatment with tumor necrosis factor, and patients on peritoneal dialysis. So these are the patients who are prone or at higher risk of developing tuberculosis as a such, and on top of that, abdominal cough. So etiology is shown in this, and out of this, the Mycobacterium tuberculosis is the main one which causes the abdominal cough. In details, we will not discuss because it will be, it has already been known to you all while you have studied microbiology. Now, coming to the basic types of abdominal tuberculosis, remember that there are four basic types. One is the intestinal type, second is the peritoneal type, third is the lymph nodes that are affected, or the mesenteric type, and solid organs. Now, in this type, the intestinal type is further divided into ulcerative and hypertrophic, peritoneal into where it involves the omentum, the peritoneum, or patient has ascites, solid organs like liver, spleen, and other. These will be discussed in detail. So these all will be discussed in detail, and out of these, the intestinal type is the commonest. Now, coming to the pathogenesis of abdominal tuberculosis, let us know two terms very clearly. First of all, primary and secondary. So, primary infection is something where a patient ingests milk, like unpasteurized milk, and the bacilli goes is swallowed and goes into the gut. And second is swallowing the sputum. If a patient is positive, has pulmonary pox, in those cases, if he swallows the sputum, the sputum reaches the GI tract. So here the chart shows the different modes of infection of abdominal tuberculosis. Number one is ingestion of contaminated milk products, and that is the primary type. Swelling of infected sputum, that is the secondary type. Third is a hematogenous spread from any pulmonary focus. And fourth is the direct spread from adjacent organs. Now, in case of abdominal cough, remember that there is reactivation of dormant focus. Okay, there is reactivation of the dormant focus. So the GI focus is established when a child is young, and suppose he has an infection of tuberculosis, it remains dormant. And due to hematogenous spread, the pulmonary focus spreads and goes into the GI tract, and it remains dormant until some further time when it reactivates. So there is reactivation of dormant focus, that is called a GI focus. The GI focus is a secondary to a pulmonary focus. So from the lungs, it goes into the kidney, into the GI tract, it remains there as a dormant one, and subsequently in future time, it reactivates. Next is the swallowed bacilli. Now, once the bacilli is swallowed, either by ingestion of contaminated milk products or swallowing of infected sputum, it reaches the ileum. Now, first, we might think that why the stomach is not so much involved. In the stomach, there is the gastric acid, which kills the bacteria. Moreover, there is the gastric emptying time is not so much. There is the stasis is not so much. So the incidence of tuberculosis in stomach is relatively very, very low. So it is high in areas where there is high amount of lymphoid follicles and there is stasis of the the fecal matter. So it is the Peyer's patches in the terminal ileum, which is the one of the commonest area where tubercular infection can occur. Now, so ingestion of food contaminated with tubercular bacilli causing primary intestinal tuberculosis, ingestion of sputum containing tuberculosis bacteria from primary focus, that is secondary, hematurin spread from the lungs through lymphatic and retrogradely from the fallopian tubes. Now, once the bacilli is swallowed, the Peyer's patches that are present in the terminal part of the ileum, the mucosa is invaded by the bacilli. Then within the mucosa and adjoining the submucosa, the epitheloid tubercles are formed. Epitheloid tubercles are formed, and after 2 to 4 weeks, they undergo caseating necrosis. So bacilli near the Peyer's patches enter below the mucosa submucosa lining. There they form epitheloid tubercles. By 2 to 4 weeks, they undergo caseating necrosis, and there is ulceration of the mucosa. This is one. Second, the macrophages that are present in the submucosa, they have M cells. So they, what they do is they phagocyte the bacilli, and through lymphatics they pass into the lymph nodes. So once you swallow, there are two things that can happen. One, it can go into the mucosa submucosa area and cause caseation necrosis. Second, it is taken up by the macrophages and through lymphatics goes into the mesenteric lymph nodes. Now, retrograde spread is something which is called direct spread, where the focus of infection is somewhere and it is spread to areas adjoining to them. So if there is an infection of the fallopian tube, tuberculous infection of the fallopian tube, then from the fallopian tube the infection can directly spread to the nearby areas. Similarly, if there is a Schwann abscess, the Schwann muscle is there, the Schwann abscess occurs, which is mainly tubercular, secondary to TB or pot spine, that can also cause direct spread. Similarly, tubercular spondylosis, it can also cause direct spread. So to remember, there are 4 ways of spread. One is hematogenous, one is lymphatic, one is a primary, and another one is secondary. So once we know the different modes of transmission, let's see the different types of abdominal cords. Now, the commonest type is the intestinal type. In intestinal type, you have the ileocecal, ileal. Besides that, you have and some in the stomach, jejunum, but these are very rare. So we'll be discussing mainly the ileocecal variety and the ileal variety here. So you see here the slide shows that the ileocecal region is the commonest, followed by the ileal region. Now the ileocecal region, there are 3 types of gross morphological types in the ileocecal tuberculosis. These are the ulcerative type, the hyperplastic type and the ulcero hyperplastic type. The ulcerative type is 60% and is seen in the ileum and in some cases the jejunum. The hyperplastic and the mixed type or the ulcero hyperplastic type generally occurs in the ileocecal region. The ileal type will be causing stricture, whereas the ulcero hyperplastic type will mainly cause obstruction or a filling of a mass. In the peritoneal type, you have the acute and chronic. These will be discussed later. Then you have the tuberculous mesenteric lymphadenitis. Here again, they are divided into various classifications, will be dealt in later. Then you have the anorectal or sigmoidal involvement, involvement of solid organs by biliary tuberculosis, involvement of the omentum, and the rare types as I discussed, the esophageal type and gastrointestinal type. So the most important to remember is the ileocecal type. So as I've already discussed, see, once the ingestion of milk or infected sputum occurs, there is entry of bacilli into the mucosa of the GI tract. There are granulomas in the submucosa. And after 2 to 4 weeks, there is caseation necrosis. Once there is caseation necrosis, two things can occur. One, the underlying mucosa can ulcerate, or from here, they spread into the deeper layer. This spread is facilitated by the macrophages. The macrophages, they spread into the deeper layers, and through the lymphatics, they spread into the adjacent lymph nodes and the peritoneum. Now we'll discuss in detail about the most common and the important type of abdominal pox, that is the ileocecal pox or the ileocecal tuberculosis. It is the most common site of abdominal tuberculosis, the reason being that the terminal ileum has pear spaces, lymphoid follicles, bacilli have affinity for them, and also because of these reasons. First of all, there is stasis of intestinal contents. Because of the ileocecal valve, the movement of the fecal matter in and around the ileocecal junction is slowed down as compared to other part of the intestine. So there is a high chance of the bacteria getting absorbed. Then there are abundant pear spaces. The medium is alkaline in comparison to gastric media. The bacterial contact time is more. The minimal digestive activity and the maximum absorption in the area. So these are the reasons because of which the ileocecal tuberculosis is the most common type. So as I already told you, in ileocecal tuberculosis, there are three types, ulcerative, hyperplastic, and ulcerohyperplastic. And out of that, the ulcerative type consists of 60% is the most common. So ileocecal tuberculosis, ulcerative type is the most common type of ileocecal tuberculosis. This ulcerative type is caused secondary to pulmonary tuberculosis. The organism is more virulent as compared to the problem causing in some other areas. It causes the infection in patients who have poor body resistance. Specific feature is the multiple circumferential transverse ulcers with skip lesions. Now we know that the ulcers are formed because the bacilli goes into the mucosa submucosa area and undergoes epithelioid change, then caseation necrosis, and ultimately the ulceration occurs. Now the ulceration in tuberculosis is specifically transverse. Transverse means if this is the long axis of the intestine, it will be perpendicular to the long axis of the intestine. This is because the lymphatic channels in the small intestine are perpendicular to the long axis. So the circumferential transverse ulcers are specific for tuberculous ulcers. Whereas in typhoid ulcers, the ulcers are generally longitudinal along the line of the long axis of the intestine. That is because of the distribution of pear spaces. So looking at the gross morphology of the ulcers, we can differentiate whether an ulcer is because of abdominal tuberculosis or enteric fever. In enteric fever, it will be along the line of the axis because of the distribution of the pair spatules. Whereas in case of tuberculosis, it will be transverse, that is perpendicular to that of the long axis of the intestine. And this is because mainly of the distribution of the lymphatic channels. It occurs mostly in the ileum and very rarely seen in the cecum. Now, long-standing ulcers, which are seen mostly in the ileum, can cause strictures. This is because with time, the caseating necrosis which occurs in the mucosa submucosa gradually spreads up to the muscularis, and there is hypertrophy of those, and with time when it heals, there is stricture formation. So the typical stricture that is formed is napkin ring strictures, and it is seen in long standing ulcers and common in the ileum. Then there is intestinal nodes involvement with caseation and abscess. The patient may present with blood in stools, diarrhea, loss of appetite and reduced weight. This is in association with all the other features that a patient of tuberculosis might present. So mild grade of fever may be there. So all other features plus blood in stool, diarrhea, loss of appetite and reduced weight. Now, because of the stricture, there are some complications which can occur. One is the acute ulcer, that is ulcer perforation, which is an acute complication. Ulcer perforation because, as I told you, there is caseating necrosis of the mucosa. It spreads gradually and ultimately, if it reaches up to the serosa, then there is a perforation of the intestine. In case of chronic complication, there is stricture formation, a typical napkin ring stricture, and which results in subacute obstruction, and patient comes with distension of abdomen, vomiting, maybe not passing stool, flatus. Here you can see the thickening of the wall and stricture formation. So if you, these are open sections of the intestine. So if you imagine that these are closed, then what happens is there is circumferential narrowing. So circumferential, this area will be dilated, this area will be dilated, and middle part there is a constriction. So the name of napkin ring constriction is there. So here you can see the constriction or this stricture. In hyperplastic variety, which constitutes about 10%, it is mainly because of the primary GI tuberculosis. So primary means there is ingestion of the bacilli. It is because there is good body resistance and less virulent organisms. So if it was more virulent and poor resistance, then this might have developed into an ulcerative type. What happens is there is chronic granulomatous lesion in the ileocecal region, and fibroblastic activity in submucosa and subserosa was thickened of the bile wall with lymph load and lard. So I don't, if you can appreciate here, see, these are caseating necrosis, this is the stricture, and the bowel wall is thickened. The wall is thickened. So when the bowel wall is thickened, the surrounding mesentery, everything is matted. So the patient has a feeling of a lump, and when you palpate, you can feel a lump in the ileocecal region. So the patient mainly presents as mass in the right iliac fossa. Mass is nodular, fixed, and firm. And the caseation in case of this hyperplastic type of tuberculosis is very rare. So remember that ulcerative type, the main problem that can occur is perforation because of the ulcer penetrating up to the serosa and causing ulceration. If that thing doesn't happen, then because of healing, the ulcers become fibrosed and cause stricture leading to subacute obstruction. Whereas in hyperplastic variety, because of the thickening of the walls of the intestine plus the adjoining lymph nodes coming in, there is a lump formation, and the most common presentation is mass in the right iliac fossa. Other features of hyperplastic tuberculosis are abdominal pain, which is seen in 90% of patients. The pain is colicky type, and in intestinal tuberculosis, mesentery we will discuss later. So in hyperplastic type of abdominal tuberculosis, the pain is mainly colicky type. Mass that is seen in the right iliac fossa is hard, nodular, fixed, non-tender, and mimics carcinoma cecum. So in differential diagnosis for appendicular lump, abdominal hyperplastic abdominal tuberculosis is one, but to differentiate between an appendicular lump and lump due to abdominal pox, here you see that the mass is non-tender, whereas in case of appendicular lump it will be tender, fixed in both the cases. In appendicular lump, the filling might not be hard. So if you find a hard, nodular, fixed and non-tender mass, so it is most likely not appendicular lump, but it is most probably abdominal tuberculosis. But differentiation has to be made between that mass and a carcinoma cecum, because in cases of carcinoma cecum leading to a lump formation, that also will be hard, nodular, fixed and non-tender. So differential diagnosis of lump in the right iliac fossa, appendicular lump, your hyperplastic type of abdominal tuberculosis and carcinoma cecum. But differentiation can be easily made by the examination and looking into the features like tenderness, fixity and the consistency. After abdominal pain, the commonest next presenting feature will be subacute intestinal obstruction, which is seen in 20% of cases. Now, as I already told you, the differential diagnosis in case of hyperplastic type of tuberculosis, which presents with a lump, will be carcinoma cecum, amebiomas, appendicular mass, lymph node mass, Schwann abscess and Crohn's disease. Out of this, carcinoma cecum is the most common differential diagnosis because of the features almost being similar. Appendicular lump you can differentiate because there is pain and the filling will not be hard. And the others will be discussed when you get cases of appendicular lump in clinics. Now coming to the investigations. So remember that what we are discussing is only the ileocecal type, that is ulcerative, and the hyperplastic type. So basic investigation will be a chest X-ray to look for the primary focus or the pulmonary involvement. Blood investigation, Monto, ELISA and serum IgG, this will only help in finding whether the patient is suffering from a pulmonary cause. ESR will be raised. As far as abdominal tuberculosis is concerned, we need to do a plain X-ray, but the features are not conclusive, but still we can see the features of intestinal obstruction if the patient has a hyperplastic type of abdominal pox coming with intestinal obstruction. We know that the patient is having an obstruction, but the main cause, whether it is because of abdominal tuberculosis or something else, is not possible with a plain abdominal X-ray. You can sometimes see a calcified lymph node. Lymph node, which can give you a clue that it is mainly because of some infection, previous infection or a healed infection in the nodes. Hollow viscous perforation, the thing is same, that you know that there is a hollow viscous perforation, but with simple plain X-ray, we don't know the real cause. So simply saying that the perforation is because of an ulcerative type of tuberculosis cannot be made simply based on the plain X-ray abdomen. And next in plain X-ray, we can see a calcified granuloma in liver. So basically, chest X-ray, blood investigation, and raised ESR, this denotes towards the infection being tuberculosis. But to be specific for abdominal tuberculosis, even X-ray will not help. Here I want to mention one more thing, is that the abdominal tuberculosis patients present with such varied symptoms that it is very difficult to diagnose it at one go, and as a result many cases are misdiagnosed and following which patients come with serious complications like obstruction, perforation and all. So as in the previous slide, here you can see that this X-ray shows multiple air fluid levels. This is called an air fluid level. The straight line here, with the black one is the gas and below this is the fluid. So here again you can see an air fluid level. Here again you can see an air fluid level. So this denotes that there is some block in the intestine, but we don't know the reason. Here this is the diaphragm. This is the diaphragm. This is gas under diaphragm. So here we have two findings. One is gas under the right dome of the diaphragm. This is a very common X-ray that we'll be seeing in specimens. So this white line is the diaphragm. Here this white line is the diaphragm. Below diaphragm you can see a black shadow here. Here also you can see a black shadow. Now remember that in the peritoneum normally no air is present. But if there is a leak or a perforation in the intestine, suppose this is the intestine and a perforation occurs here. So the gas in the intestine leaks out from the intestine into the peritoneal cavity. So when the patient stands up, the air tends to go up. It goes up and here is the diaphragm. So beyond the, above the diaphragm, it cannot go and it gets collected just below the diaphragm. So this gas below the diaphragm is not normal. In case of left side, this is the left side, here you have the stomach and the fundus of the stomach is present here. This gas in the left side is the fundal gas shadow. That is, the gas in the fundus of the stomach is in a normal finding. Whereas in the right side, if you find the same gas shadow below the diaphragm, it denotes that there is a perforation in a hollow viscus. So please remember, in an X-ray, if you find gas under the diaphragm in the right side, it is pathological, whereas gas in the left side of the diaphragm is because of the fundal gas shadow. So one finding here is gas under diaphragm, which denotes a perforation. Second are multiple air fluid levels, which show some sort of obstruction. But the main problem with chest X-ray is we know that there is a problem, but don't know whether it is because of abdominal tuberculosis or any other reason. Ultrasound abdomen. In ultrasound abdomen, there are some findings which can give you a clue that there is a possibility of tuberculous abdominal infection. One is the thickening of the bowel, then loculated ascites, that is the peritoneal ascites we'll discuss later, interloop ascites, mesenteric thickening, some lymph node enlargement, and a pulled up cecum. These are called pseudo kidney signs. So if you have all these, don't need to remember this, but remember that some features in ultrasound abdomen can give you a clue that the patient is suffering from abdominal tuberculosis. Coming to the next X-ray, the barium X-ray. Last time I discussed about the various types of barium X-rays. One is the barium swallow, where you need to know any pathology in the esophagus. Barium meal for the stomach. Barium meal follow through for the small intestine. So here, and barium enema. So here either barium enema or the barium follow through. And this gives typical features in case of abdominal tuberculosis. Because of the chronic fibrosis occurring from abdominal tuberculosis, the cecum is pulled up. So from the right iliac fossa, cecum is pulled slightly up towards the right lumbar area. Now the obtuse iliocecal angle. Normally the cecum and the ilium, they form an since the cecum is pulled up, the ilium which was attached, the angle becomes obtuse. Normally it is like this, but since cecum is contracted, is pulled up, so the angle it becomes obtuse and it is called a gooseneck deformity. The gooseneck is deformity is also because of the cecum being dilated, the terminal ilium being dilated, and the cecum being pulled up. Next is something called Stirling sign, where there is hurrying of the barium due to rapid flow and lack of barium in inclined side. Due to the chronic fibrosis and thickening of the bowel wall, the normal folds of the bowel are not there, and the normal peristaltic waves which create the ostracians are also not there. So here you will see a straight pipe-like feel of barium, and the time of transit is also very high. So here they have we have what we mean is hurrying of barium due to the rapid flow. Next is a Fleischner sign or the inverted up umbrella sign. This is because of the narrowing of the ilium with thickened ileocecal valve. Now the because of the infection in the ileocecal area, the ileocecal valve becomes thickened. And because of this thickened ileocecal valve, there is narrowing sometimes of the terminal ileum. Remember that all these findings are not present in each patient. In some patients, you might see Stirling sign. In some patients, you might see this sign. As far as if a long question comes or if you get a case of this, simply remember the name of these signs and at least the basic of these two, the Stirling sign and the Fleischner sign. These mega ileum, chicken intestine and Napkin lesions, even if you don't mention it will be no problem. So please remember Stirling sign and Fleischner sign. One is hurrying of barium due to rapid flow and lack of barium in inflamed side. Next is the Fleischner sign, that is narrow ileum with thickened ileocecal valve. You can appreciate here, see, the cecum is shrunken and it has been pulled up, which is being denoted by the arrow. Ilium is narrowed, and this pulling up of the cecum is because of the fibrosis and of the colon as well as the mesocolon. So there is mesentery of the colon. Because of infection, the mesentery becomes shrunken and the cecum is pulled up. So there is pulling up of the cecum and narrowing of the ileum. A very specific finding can be if a patient is subjected to colonoscopy. Now in colonoscopy, we can see the real-time image, and one of the most important advantages, you can take a biopsy to establish the diagnosis. So here, if you can visualize, there are multiple ulcers in the ileum. So from these ulcers, you can take the biopsy and it can give a conclusive diagnosis. Moreover, the colonoscopy shows strictures, nodules, deformed ileocecal valve, colitis, edema, everything. And you can rule out malignancy. So if you are suspecting ileocecal tuberculosis, you can advise colonoscopy, and a biopsy can be taken from the ulcer, which can give a specific diagnosis towards ileocecal pox. Now this CT scan of abdomen, don't need to go into detail. Again, it helps to give some features which tend to help the clinician diagnose that it is the patient is suffering from abdominal tuberculosis. So there is thickening of the cecum and some mesenteric lymph node that see. These are the mesenteric lymph nodes, calcified lymph node that you can see, and the cecum is thickened. So these findings are generally not seen in any other cases. So next is the diagnostic laparoscopy. This is mainly useful for cases of peritoneal tuberculosis or omental tuberculosis that will be discussed later. Other investigations are polymerase chain reaction or PCR of tissue. Either you can send a PCR of tissue from the biopsy that has been taken from the colonoscopy. In some cases, a patient will have ascites and we will do the ascite fluid tapping. This will be discussed in peritoneal type, and even in medicine when they discuss abdominal, pulmonary cough, you can know the different types of exudative fluid and glucose. But PCR of tissue and ascitic tap analysis can show you some findings which will give you a clue that the patient is more towards a tuberculosis, like adenosine deaminase activity. If ADA is high, it is 95% specific and 98% sensitive that the patient is suffering from cox. And if it is from ascitic fluid, you know that the ascitic fluid has tuberculous bacilli. Similarly, if the lymphocyte the fluid has lymphocyte of more than 250, then it gives a clue that most probably it is because of tuberculosis. But ADA is very sensitive, and PCR of tissue is also very important in diagnosis. Now, the complications of ileocecal tuberculosis, either hyperplastic or ulcerative type. So one is obstruction, which is mostly seen in the hyperplastic type, which is seen in 20% of cases. Malabsorption or blind loop syndrome. This is because of the normal mucosal vigosities are lost. The absorptive capacity of the intestine is diminished, and patients suffer from malabsorption. Dissemination of tuberculosis, that is tuberculosis from one area spreads to other area, that is also come under the complication. Cold abscess formation means there will be abscess with not the typical features of a general abscess. There will be no rising. All the signs of inflammation will be absent. Then hemorrhage, perforation, and fecal fistula. These will be in the ulcerative type. The hemorrhagic type, perforative type, and fecal fistula. Coming to the treatment of ileocecal type of tuberculosis. First is the medical management. Details will be discussed when you have a class of medicine of pulmonary cough. But just to name, first line drugs are isoniazid, rifampicin, pyrazinamide, thimethoprim. Second line drugs are this. We will not discuss this in detail. Just coming to the surgical management of ileocecal tuberculosis. Now, there are three things which happened. Previously, when no anti-tubercular drugs or the anti-tubercular drugs that were available were not effective, then there was one type of surgery that was being performed. That is, suppose the ileum, terminal part of the ileum and cecum is involved. What they used to do is, they used to join the proximal part of the ileum to the transverse colon. So, it was a sort of bypass, maybe 3 feet or 4 feet away from the ileocecal junction. That part of the ileum they will take and join to the transverse colon. So food will come from the jejunum up to the ileum, not reach the terminal ileum, and from there directly go to the transverse colon, bypassing the cecum and ascending colon. So that was a bypass surgery, but problem is you have left an area of terminal part of ileum, the cecum, the ascending colon as a blind loop. So with advent of drugs, new regimes, this has changed. And nowadays many definite surgical treatments are being carried out. So the indications of surgery are if a patient has intestinal obstruction, if there is severe hemorrhage, if there is a perforation, there is an abscess or fistula formation, or in some cases of uncertain diagnosis. So remember that surgical management is done only in some specific situations or complications like intestinal obstruction, severe hemorrhage, perforation, abscess fistula formation, or uncertain diagnosis. Now, as I told you previously, it was simply a bypass. The main area was left, the area of ileocecal tuberculosis or the area of the terminal ileum and the cecum was left behind. A bypass was created between the ileum and the transverse colon, and the patient used to take anti-tubercular drugs, but the problem was still there. Now, these are the approaches which are being followed. So if there is an stricture because of ulcerative type of abdominal tuberculosis. So stricture means a narrowing. So a part of the intestine is narrow, and because of that, the patient has developed subacute obstruction. What we do is we cut five centimeter margin from either side of the stricture, and we do a anastomosis. So if the middle part is a stricture, cut the disease segment, and this and this part we join, and the patient continues with the medical treatment. Next is the strictureplasty. This is the most commonly followed operation if there is only a single stricture. So what is done if there is a narrowing? Suppose there is a narrowing in the tube. So we cut the tube along the long axis and again suture it in the perpendicular axis. So this is difficult until and unless we meet. Maybe when things are okay, when we meet, I will show you, at least show you what is a strictureplasty. Now, if there is a single stricture, then you can do a strictureplasty. If there are multiple strictures, one stricture here, one stricture there, one up 5 feet away, 1 2 feet away, then this strictureplasty is difficult because it itself is a operation. So every time, every segment you have to operate, practically not feasible. So in those cases, what we do is we cut the total segment. So starting from the first stricture to the last stricture, whatever amount of intestine is involved, we remove that, and then the remaining healthy part we anastomose. Then multiple strictureplasty can be done, but the preferable is the resection and anastomosis. If patient presents with perforation, then resection and anastomosis is done, because if there is a hole, we tend to repair the area of that part of the intestine where there is perforation is not healthy, because if there is epithelioid formation, case eating necrosis, then an ulcer formation. If you try to simply repair or close the hole with sutures, that will not hold. So the preferred way is resect some part of the intestine with that perforation, and then anastomosis. Perforation with severe contamination. Suppose their area is perforated, and from that perforated side, stool, fecal matter, everything is spread in the peritoneal cavity. Then what we do is we can simply resect and bring out as a colostomy. Next is adhesiolysis by laparoscopy, which is a difficult procedure. And last is drainage of an abscess and treatment for fistula in anemia. That would be covered in case of when you discuss the perineal type. So next is the ileal tuberculosis. Remember that till now we have discussed what is called the ileocecal tuberculosis. Now specifically ileal tuberculosis. It is mainly the type where strictures is formed. There will be multiple strictures present with intestinal obstruction. Because of the stricture, the patient will come with obstruction. And there is adhesion, localization, and fibrosis. Perforation can occur in only 5% of cases. In plain X-ray abdomen, you see multiple air fluid levels like the X-ray I have shown you in the previous slides. Treatment is nothing but resection and anastomosis. So you resect that part of the intestine where the stricture is there, anastomose, and continue and treat the patient with anti-tubercular drugs. So that will be the end of today. Next time we will continue with peritoneal tuberculosis, then tuberculosis of some solid organs, and perineal tuberculosis. But to the main take-home message from here is, because of the prevalence and incidence of tuberculosis in India, it is a very serious health problem, a communicable disease which kills maybe just after AIDS. It is the second most highest killer as far as communicable disease is concerned. Diagnosis is very difficult because the patient presents with varied and various types of symptoms. No specific tests are available which will point out and say that this patient is suffering from abdominal pox. You have to do various type of investigation. The presentation is various. Patient may simply come with fever and weight loss. Some might come with diarrhea. Some will come with perforation. Some might come with obstruction. Out of all these, the ileocecal tuberculosis is the commonest. Ileocecal tuberculosis has three types: ulcerative, hyperplastic, and ulcerative hyperplastic. Ulcerative type can present with acute emergency like perforation or chronic complication like stricture. Hyperplastic type will generally present with mass in the right iliac fossa, and it has to be differentiated from carcinoma cecum and appendicular lump. Investigation as such for pulmonary pox like chest X-ray, blood, and everything is there, but specifically if you want to diagnose, then there are some indications given in ultrasound, some indications in CT scan. We can do a colonoscopy, we can take a biopsy from that and send it for PCR and do ADA analysis. As far as treatment is concerned, patient is started on anti-tubercular drugs, and we prefer not to intervene until and unless required so. But if a patient has come with perforation, has subacute obstruction or a hemorrhage, then there is no point in continuing with anti-tubercular drugs. We need to operate. So only in some specific situations, a patient of abdominal tuberculosis is operated. Operation was, as I told you, has developed with stages. First of all, previously what was done, the area of the ileum, terminal ileum and cecum with the tuberculosis part was left behind. Ileum maybe 4 or 5 feet from the ileocecal junction was taken and was joined to the transverse colon. With new drugs being developed, nowadays surgery can be done. So if it is a stricture, single stricture, we can do something what is called a strictureoplasty. Simply remember the name. If there are multiple strictures, we can do resection of the entire segment or multiple strictureoplasty, which is tiresome or practically maybe not feasible. If there is perforation, simply closing the perforation might not suffice because the tissue is not healthy. And in case of perforation, what we do is simply resect that part. We cut that part. Suppose the perforation is here, we cut from here, here. We remove this part and then anastomose. Remember, as long as the patient is undergoing surgery, post-operative period, and maybe 6-8 months after that, the anti-tubercular medication has to be continued. It is not that once you treat patient with surgery, the medication has to be stopped. Antitubercular drugs should be continued, and surgery is indicated only in extreme situation where the medical treatment will not help. Last is the ileal tuberculosis you discard, it may, mainly where only the ileum is involved. It is mainly of the stricture type. Perforation is very rare. You can diagnose it with an X-ray, but you don't know whether it is a tuberculosis type. But if it is a stricture or a perforation, you have to open the and put the patient for operation. Once patient is operated, we find stricture. So it depends on the number of strictures what we do. So mainly resection and anastomosis or a strictureoplasty along with anti-tubercular drugs. So next time we'll discuss about the other things that I told you. So this is end for today. Thank you.